We're going to talk just briefly. They told me to talk quickly, which I have no problem doing, about just three or four things that we do in structural heart. And I was asked to say, pretend people don't know what we do at all, people that might not be in cardiology, and show them a little bit behind the curtain about what we actually do. So let me show you a little bit here about some of the things we do. So transcatheter aortic valve replacement is a procedure in which we treat patients that have a diseased aortic valve. And usually that valve is very calcified and very stiff and stenotic. And the valve just does not open very well. And treatment of choice for these particular patients has to be some sort of replacement. There's not very many medications we can use to try and stop the process. Some of our patients are born with a congenital abnormality. It may be a two-leaflet or a bicuspid valve. Some people have had rheumatic heart disease from rheumatic fever, and the most common of which are age-related calcific degenerative AS, where these, we get all these calcified nodules and things that, that form on the valve, and the valve won't open. And eventually, this will lead to symptoms. Our population is living longer, partially from the therapies that are brought about through cardiovascular and cancer therapies. And the longer we have patients live, the more disease processes we'll run into. And a lot of them are related to heart-related diseases, some of which we'll show you today. So we know from even in the 1960s, when Eugene Brunwald and his team followed patients that had rheumatic aortic valve disease, that patients can do well for a very long time. But at the point where they start to do poorly, their mortality increases substantially. So once you start to have symptoms of chest pain, shortness of breath, or something related to your valve disease, your chance of dying in 5 years is almost certain. So you need to do something about it. So traditionally, open heart surgery was done, and it still remains the standard of care for many patients that have valvular heart disease, including aortic valve disease. But what we found that there's a lot of patients initially that were too sick and just were not great candidates for surgical valve replacement. So we needed options. Rather than patients dying of their disease, we need to have other options. And the first company out on the market, I won't show you the original valves, was Edwards Lifesciences. Medtronic has a valve out as well. Abbott has a valve out as well. And I'll show you some of these valves here today. These are valves that we can place without surgical intervention. Most of the time now we're going through one of the blood vessels in the legs, the femoral artery, making our way up to the valve and placing a valve inside. Here's what this looks like. On the left-hand side, you can see us just taking a picture inside the aorta. And on the right-hand side, you can see a valve that's been crimped down on a balloon. We pace the heart quickly so the blood pressure goes down a little bit, and then we can inflate that balloon, and we put the valve in place. So we move the old aortic valve out of the way. This new valve starts to function right away underneath it, and we've taken a patient from a critical disease to now a new aortic valve without having to undergo surgical valve replacement. Here's what the self-expanding valve looks like. I'll show you again the aortic shot. We try and line everything up, make sure we're in the right plane. Sometimes we stretch the valve with a little balloon to create some space, and then we can bring in the valve and slowly deploy these valves. This is what we call a self-expanding valve by Medtronic. And we can set this valve in there slowly, slowly, make sure the valve's in the right place. Again, moving the old valve out of the way and having the new valve start to function right away. So once we stop the pacing process, the next beat that the patient has, they're pushing blood through a normal valve again. So these are things that now can really be done in about 55, 60 minutes or so. Most of the time it can be done in a cath lab. We have a hybrid OR, which allows us to do them there. But they can be done in the cath lab with really low complication rates and great success. This past year was the first year in the U.S. where transcatheter valves were done more than surgical valves for patients with severe aortic valve stenosis. And as long as the durability is there, the trend will continue. We have ways that we can put up little filters to try and protect the brain during the procedure as well. And then there are devices in clinical research right now being placed for patients with aortic insufficiency or leaks that would allow us to treat patients with any type of aortic valve disease. And the clinical trials for these have recently finished, and we'll have some data on them soon. So what about closing off left atrial appendages? We spent this last few minutes talking about opening up a blockage. Now, what about closing an opening that's already there, right? So these are patients that have irregular heartbeats, atrial fibrillation. And in certain patient populations, that atrial fibrillation increases your risk of a blood clot. And the majority of these blood clots can form in the heart in what we call the left atrial appendage. The treatment of choice for any patient with AFib who has risk factors would be anticoagulation of some variety taken by oral medications. But some patients can't do that due to bleeding, recent cancer, recurrent falls, really a lot of falls. And we need some way to try and help these patients as well. If you're going for some sort of other heart surgery, a lot of times our surgical colleagues will now remove that left atrial appendage. And what it is this little outpouching that sticks off the left atrium. And blood does not flow through that appendage very quickly. And when there's not great flow in the top chambers of the heart or the atrium, blood can become stagnant and we can form blood clots in that left atrial appendage. And this is an ultrasound. You can just see these clots that hang out there. And if they just stayed there, that'd be great, but they don't. They then embolize to the brain, giving patients strokes. So if this appendage didn't exist, if there was a way to block it off, that would be fantastic, right? So we have ways that we can go through the femoral vein again, go across from the right atrium to the left atrium, and now we're looking right at that left atrial appendage. We can get inside that left atrial appendage and then place devices that help close it off. And then over time, here's what we call a kind of a tug test. You can see Dr. Singh and colleagues, they want to make sure that thing's not coming out, right? So they put in there and they try and pull on that thing to make sure that the little barbs that are holding it in there are going to hold this little device in there. And then we have ways to just close it off and it'll seal up over time and patients can come off of anticoagulation. This is the Watchman implant. There are other implants and the Watchman has gone through certain iterations, and the iteration which is out now and approved in 2020 is even more effective and easier to use for certain patients. So there's an amplatzer occluder as well that we can put in the left atrial appendage. So lots of ways to help people out. I'll end with telling you briefly about the mitral and tricuspid work, which is ongoing here. The mitral valve is extremely complex, and the tricuspid valve is even more complex than that. So the aortic valve turns out to be probably the easiest valve that we work on. The mitral valve itself has got, between the two leaflets, supporting structures, muscles, chordae. There's lots of stuff that help the mitral valve function well and not allow it to leak. But if it does leak, lots of times patients would go for surgical mitral valve repair, which Dr. Kia, Dr. Katrip, Evans, Wozniak, et cetera, here can work on patients with mitral valve disease. And our surgeons have many ways to try and repair that mitral valve. In patients who are too sick, sometimes as a bailout procedure, they'll sew the middle of the two leaflets together, allowing the patient to have two separate orifices or two separate holes for blood to get through, but it decreases the leak down the middle. This brought on a way to, you know, trying to find ways that we could do this for patients who were not surgical candidates who could get clips placed through a transcatheter means. And this is how mitral clip began. You can see here on the upper left, any of that color that's going backwards to the upper top part of the screen is mitral regurgitation. Patients, we can go in, put these clips in, and then the amount of color flow on the upper right has been markedly diminished. I would say it rarely goes to zero. But if you could take a patient with severe mitral regurgitation and take them down somewhere into a mild range, the patients will do much better. And again, initially designed for patients that were not surgical candidates. And even today, they need optimal medical therapy to treat heart failure before a clip should even be considered. These are ways, once again, that patients don't have to undergo traditional open heart surgery. You saw, and I'll show you the team, that here just did the first transcatheter valve replacements for the mitral valve. Some going through the interatrial septum, some going through the apex of the heart. And both of these techniques and strategies are under clinical research and ongoing here right now to actually replace these valves, not just put clips or try and repair them, but replace these valves without traditional heart surgery. And the techniques are getting easier and will be more defined in the future. There's the team there, the first transfemoral transseptal mitral valve procedure on the West Coast. You can see Dr. Kia and colleagues, Dr. Singh, Dr. Rogers, Dr. Smith's in the back hanging out, and the team there. Dr. Rogers got his arms folded. He's ready to have lunch, maybe. It was a long day for him. That case took a lot out of him. He's getting older. So one brief thing about the tricuspid, initially thought to be the forgotten valve. We weren't going to be able to do much for it. That tricuspid valve is extremely complicated in trying to deal with it surgically and through transcatheter means. There are a myriad of companies that are trying to treat tricuspid regurgitation, mainly because if you look at patients with severe tricuspid regurgitation or a leaky valve, Patients that have high blood pressure in their lungs or pulmonary hypertension, patients with severe leaky valves do not last very long. So if we can get to these patients early on and try and either get them medically treated or do something to help out the tricuspid valve, we can extend the life of these particular patients. So not everyone can have surgery, and trying to find ways to fix these leaky heart valves through transcatheter means are being done. The first ways that they're being done, again, are with clip procedures to try and clip these valves tight and closed to prevent their leak. Patients can go from significant leaks to less leaks. And there are multiple strategies right now ongoing and ongoing clinical trials with multiple different companies to try and either repair or replace these valves. And a lot of trials we have ongoing here at UC Davis as well. So again, if one or two clips is good, what if we could replace these valves? So there are ways now that I'll show you that we can try and replace the tricuspid valve as well. And again, Edwards leads the innovation in this field along with other companies. I'll show you a video here of going up through the femoral vein, up through the inferior vena cava towards the right atrium. We'll make our way across the tricuspid valve, and I'll show you how this one particular valve works. Again, there's a lot that goes on when you watch this video. It makes it look pretty easy to do, but there are many things that go on to try and make sure you make it through the center of the valve. You don't get caught on the cords. You don't catch a papillary muscle. You don't injure the right ventricle, which is quite thin. You could perforate it with your wires. And then you have to be able to kind of gather all the leaflets of the tricuspid valve and kind of gather and grab them with your device before you deploy this valve. So as you'll see, it becomes a little complex, but there's ways in which you can get a hold of all these leaflets, make sure that you have a good grasp, and then you'll deploy this valve in its position, getting rid of tricuspid regurgitation. I'll show you as this valve's deployed in a slow and steady way. And the tricuspid valves are clearly much bigger than closing a left atrial appendage or putting in a transcatheter valve. So you'll see after this valve is released, it's in place. There's no suture. Everything has to be properly fit with proper ways to grasp the anatomy that's there. Right, there's no way to go back with bubble gum and duct tape once you let go of it, right? And then the valve can start working right away. So I'll tell you that this is in clinical trials. It has been done in humans already. And some of these are from Dr. Kadali, et cetera. So the future, I would tell you, is bright for structural heart disease. I think the burden of proof is on us to make sure that we can do a job as well as our surgical colleagues. If not, we should not be doing it. And if the durability of what we do is not the same as surgery, then we should not be doing it as well. So even though we can do things, I think the burden is to make sure that we can do it in a way that helps the patient as well as the techniques that they have available to them right now.